We're going to go on a journey to the summit of Everest and back down. But the first idea I want to give you is this one. You can't keep courage in thermal. I love this. It was the title of a chapter of a book by this gentleman. And I think for me it sums up the fact that you can't bottle it up. You can't bottle it up when you need it most. But when you're exhausted, when you're cold, tired, in pain, for when you're worried about something, for when you're fearing something. And there were lots of moments when I feared things about Everest, about going to Everest, before I even stood on the mountain. And the biggest of those fears, and I'll admit, is the fear of failure. What if it all went wrong? What if I didn't do it? What if I wasn't fit enough? What if I told all my friends and family that I was going to be the first Welsh woman to climb Mount Everest? And what if they just looked at me and said, well, you've got more than you can chew, you'll never do it, and what if I fail? But counterbalancing this was, what if I could become the first Welsh woman to climb Mount Everest? And what if I could become the youngest British female to do so? These were the opportunities that were in front of me, and I couldn't let them disappear. The journey to the summit of Everest is not a short one, and it's not a direct one either. And the 18 months of preparation that went into this expedition were intense. The training regime, 6 days a week, all sorts of different training. I even gave up my full-time job to concentrate on fitness training. And the sponsorship that I needed to gather for the expedition. £54,000 I was looking for, something that I didn't have in my back pocket. And this period of preparation was littered with highs and lows, emotional ones. Emotional highs when I secured that bit of kit that I needed for free, some lovely outdoor provider gave it to me. But those emotional lows when I approached yet another sponsor and they said, you've never got a chance to get to the summit of Everest. I'm sorry we can't support you. But I was saying, but look, I've got a track record. I've done the Polar Challenge. I know I don't look like someone that can climb Everest, but come on, please, support me. I'm going to be the first Welsh woman. But I was met with rejection after rejection after rejection. Now, from those highs and lows, and I did secure most of the funding in the end, came the highs and lows of Everest itself. And this is the thing that surprises most people. The thing that most people comment on when I've told them about climbing the summit of Everest. It's not simply possible to set up a base camp and go up to camp 1, 2, 3, 4, summit, and off you go home again. The reason for that is that when you climb the high mountains around the world, there's this lack of oxygen. It's the altitude. And you've got to acclimatize to that. And so what you need to spend time doing is going up and down the mountain, like a yo-yo, from base camp to camp 1 and back down again. From base camp to camp 2 and back down again. Constantly retracing those footsteps, going through the same areas of danger on the mountain, such as the ice fall here. And it's deceiving. You're probably looking at this photograph and thinking it's cold. Yes, I mentioned minus 40 already. But there's these extremes of temperature as well, and higher up the mountain you're actually battling with plus 30, with heat stroke, heat exhaustion, sunburn. The altitude as well, you can develop acute mountain sickness leading to pulmonary edema, cerebral edema. The effect that has on you as a climber is that you constantly have a headache. You lose your appetite. You can't sleep at night. And these things compound throughout the whole length of the expedition, and there were days upon days when I wondered whether I actually mustered the energy to go on and do the next one. There were obvious dangers as well, and these are visible all around you when you're on the mountain. A helicopter that met its end because the blade simply couldn't get enough lift at base camp. That's at 5,500 meters. Everest itself is 8,850 meters high, or 29,035 feet. We've got the tombstones, the climbers that have lost their lives in previous years. And it's a very vivid mark of the dangers that you're facing and the fact that every year someone loses their life on this mountain. Avalanches, things you can't control, things that are beyond your control. These are risks that you're putting yourself up against. And in this photograph here, just if you can make it out in the ice, a tent that has been blasted out of Camp 2 and is now trapped under 3 years worth of snow and ice. Everest isn't a short trip. I spent 2 months on the mountain just doing up and down, up and down, up and down. And essentially what you're waiting for are the weather conditions to come good on the summit. For the strong winds to die down and for you and your team to head towards the summit of Everest. And initially, after this yo-yo effect of going up and down the mountain, and your body getting used to the lack of oxygen, physiologically it was making more red blood cells so that it could carry what the oxygen there was around your body. We were given the go. The 17th of May was going to be my summit date, this date that I'd waited for 18 months that I'd set my sights on for that amount of time. And I went up to Camp 1 and to Camp 2. But Camp 2, I got ill. And was faced with the decision to make that I had to turn around. My teammates were going to carry on to the summit of Everest, but I got ill. So ill that I won't be surprised that you wouldn't want to be like that in your own home, let alone at 6,500 metres on the side of Everest. And so I let my teammates go on and I turned around, potentially giving up all those hard months of work and missing out on the chance of reaching the summit of Everest and achieving those goals that I'd set myself. And I was devastated, as this photo shows. And I watched my teammates reach the summit, and I thought, you know, will I ever get the chance to go back up again? But the good news was that a week later, I did recover, and the jet stream moved north again, those strong winds moved from the summit, and the weather window opened up. You need for the summit of Everest in the dead of night, which seems like a pretty ridiculous idea. But the reason for that is that you try and climb through the night to reach the summit in the early hours of the morning so that then you can come back down again safely in daylight. Because most climbers expend all their energy on the way up and forget that they've actually got to come back down again. In this photograph, we've got oxygen masks on, we've got tanks in our back. It's very claustrophobic. You're in this little world of your own, cocooned in a down suit with boots on and crampons that weigh about a kilogram each. You're in the death zone. This is the zone in which human life cannot be sustained without supplemental oxygen indefinitely. And it feels like that. Every step you take, you're left gasping for breath as they just run the 100 metres. And the exposure is quite simply terrifying. That is Camp 4. We're now climbing above Camp 4, on and up to the summit. You've got drops to your right, 2,000 metres into Nepal, and 3,000 metres into Tibet. They are terrifying, and it's a case of making sure you put your foot in the right place, because one mistake, and if the ropes don't hold, you will fall to your death. It's about a 10-hour climb to the summit of Everest for most climbers, and you go up this summit ridge. And about 5 hours in, the sun started to come up, but my body hurt. I was in pain. It just ached from the months previous and days of climbing beforehand, and I was running out of energy. You don't feel like eating at altitude, and that compounds the problem. And my thoughts wandered, and they wandered to a memory of me as a child doing some cooking with my nan, and I was trying to open a jar of jam, and I said to my nan, "Oh nan, I can't open this jam, can you help me?" And she took the jar of jam from me and then gave it back to me. And she said, "There's no such word as can't. Go on, you can do it." And as I was climbing up the ridge in a world of my own, I reflected on this, and I turned what my nan had said on its head, and I turned it into, "I can, I can, I can." And with every footstep that I took, I just said to myself, "I can, I can, I can. And if I keep putting one foot in front of the other, I will make it to the summit of Everest." It really was an incredible feeling sitting on top of the world. It was a very proud moment, and I wanted my family to see me there in real time, but of course they couldn't. You can see from the footage we had clear skies, and the subtitles was actually filmed on a phone. So it's amazing, on a Nokia phone, it's amazing what you can actually capture when you're in those strong winds and the temperature's down to minus 40. I sat there for about 30 minutes, and after those 30 minutes, my hands got so numb, all we had to do was take the photos and get out of there. Because getting to the summit of Everest, you're only halfway there. There's really no opportunity to celebrate up there, because in the back of your mind, you know you've got to get back down safely. You really can't celebrate until you're back down at base camp. And that's a two-day walk, climb, trek, before you can really start to celebrate. And I have hundreds and hundreds of memories of this trip, and so many things that I've learned, but one of the things that really, really stands out for me is the friendships and the camaraderie that you get on these trips, and the fact that I didn't climb Everest on my own. There were literally hundreds of people around me that supported me, my immediate teammates, my Sherpas, other climbers, and back home, friends, family, work colleagues, sponsors, the media, all those people supported me one way or another to get to the summit of Everest. And it's moments like this, when you're high-fiving a fellow climber in the ice fall, one of the most notorious parts of the mountain, that you really need that encouragement, that support from other people, so that you believe that you really can do it. But when you're alone on that ridge, going towards the summit, you really are in a world of your own, and you have to rely on something that comes from up here. And for me, my thoughts were those of when I was a child, and of my nan and this jar of jam. And the point that I really want to make this evening is that it's the things that people say to you that can often have the greatest impact. It might be from your childhood, it might be a throwaway comment, but it's how you pick up on them and how you make them to be trigger words, if you like, when you really, really need them. And it's being able to tap into them when you really, really need them. So we heard at the start, you can't keep courage in a thermal. And I think that's true. I think Ernest has got it right. I was looking at Twitter the other day, receiving some messages, and I saw this. Success comes in camps, not cars. And I think that's true as well. But for me, and my experience on Everest, it's all about the jam jar. Thank you very much.